Hi, everybody, and welcome to this last session of our two-day event. We are now going to have a panel discussion about AI and cognitive science, and it will be moderated by Nadia Sarayoko, who is a journalist. She's also a PhD candidate in UCAM and also a lecturer. So before leaving her moderate this panel, I also would like to remind that it's organized by Cognitive Science Institute, jointly organized by Cognitive Sciences Institute and the new Research Center on AI. The first one is a well-established, already old institution. It's about 20 years old. And the second one is quite young, I would say 20 weeks. Okay, so enjoy.
Thank you. Well, I would like to introduce to you the panelists that will be participating. You've probably seen them a bit earlier today, but still, we have Doriana M. Dadona, who's associate professor at the Università degli Studi Napoli Federico II. Is that not too bad? Okay. Her main research interests are focused on manufacturing processes and automation, intelligent computation for manufacturing technology and systems. She's a member of national and international scientific associations in the field of production engineering, International Academy for Production Engineering, and Associazione Italiana di Tecnologia Meccanica. I've heard the Italian being spoken before, but I'm not that good, though I have an Italian name. Christine P. Bennett is Associate Director of the Institute for Data Exploration and Application, and she's also a professor in the Mathematical Science and Computer Science departments at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. Her research focuses on extracting information data using novel predictive or descriptive mathematical models and data visualization and the applications of these methods to support decision making and to accelerate discovery in science, engineering, public health and business. She has 25 years of experience and over 100 publications in these areas. Jim, or James, as he's also known, yeah. Jim, you would better say Jim, eh? That's what I've heard. Jim Endler at Thetherless World is a professor in computer science, web and cognitive science at the Department of Cognitive Science at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, and the director of Rensselaer Institute for Data Exploration and Applications. He is the author of more than 400 publications in the field of artificial intelligence, robotics, agent-based computing, and high-performance processing. He is one of the creators of the semantic web. That's quite something, creator of the semantic, sorry, like we all have our little things that we like too much. And of course, our local speaker, Stephen Arnad, who is a professor of cognitive psychology here at UCAM and a renowned researcher of the categorization, language, and consciousness. For many years, he fought for free access in scientific research, and more recently, his activism is focused on animal rights and welfare. So that's why you're saving animals later on today. He was the founder and former editor-in-chief of the journal Behavioral and Brain Sciences, and the current editor-in-chief of the journal Animal Sentience. So my vegan joke was not too much out of place with you. Mounir Boukadoum is a professor here at UCAM of microelectronics engineering. His current research covers the application of artificial intelligence and nature-inspired techniques to analysis and design problems, especially in relation to biomedical outcomes. Mr. Boukadoum is currently director of the Design and Fabrication Laboratory at UCAM and president of the IEEE, the Computational Intelligence Society's Montreal chapter, and the executive member of the Quebec Strategic Alliance for Microsystem Research Consortium.
You left out something.
Yes, I did.
His daughter is vegan.
Oh, so it's all like, I really have drawn a web of like relationships here, yes. With you and the animals. His daughter is vegan. Oh, I think we're all going to confess about our eating habits very soon in this panel.
I think we should add a question.
Whoa. Maybe you know, like we have an open space for other type of questions, so maybe you could discuss this later. So we will start this panel by discussing the current dominant trend in artificial intelligence, AI research, so which is deep learning, and that has almost evicted from the field the complementary symbolic AI current. The first question on this topic is, can you give us your take on where this opposition is heading to? Who would like to start on this question?
We both talked about it in our presentations. I think we can both summarize what we said.
Oh, you could totally do that. So okay. You would like to start, Stephen?
Unless you want to start. It's a false opposition.
Great.
Okay, because what is symbolic AI? It's computational models. Okay, mm-hmm. That's symbolic. Well, neural nets are computational models too. Mm-hmm. That's the short answer. But neural nets are specialized in learning. And there's a missing component in the classical AI approach, the symbolic one, which is how do symbols get connected to their reference? And a very good way to connect them to their reference is to put a neural net in between the input and the symbolic system so that the symbolic system can actually learn what's what in the world. That's hybrid AI. It's partly symbolic and it's partly dynamic.
So no opposition, just something, some kind of hybridization happening. No.
But it has to be said that neural nets are having more dramatic successes these days than classical AI.
So I kind of agree, and in my talk I talked about some of the phenomena that the neural nets don't handle that the more symbolic AI had. But when I want to really sum it up quickly, my belief is this: if just simply evolving networks could lead to symbols, then we should be able to have discussions with our dogs and our cats and, you know, other things. In other words, in all of evolution, we only know of one entity that has evolved this complex symbol system, right? Now, some people argue that for mystical reasons, some for religion, but clearly it must be a complicated thing. So again, I feel like studying that middle place that Stephen was talking about is important because we need to understand how it really works and what's different about sort of the symbolic system from just a learning system.
Maybe I could go with another sub-question on that topic so we can keep on going. Absolutely. Would you say that deep learning alone can lead all the way to the ultimate goal of the AI field, the artificial general intelligence in the machine? So Munir, you would like to start on this?
The short answer is no.
Yes. Do we have a longer answer, though?
Does this thing work? No, it doesn't. OK, I'll yell.
Go.
As I said.
I might have to turn on.
Or maybe I should turn this on.
Move it's from on. Mute to on. At the top, there's...
It's on.
No, you can't tell by seeing red. See the top to see if it's on mute or on.
No, but it seems to...
It works. Okay, go.
All right. I'm not sure, actually, that I entirely agree with what was said before.
Good.
Because if you look at the history of things, this whole concept of artificial intelligence, if you look at it from a computer science perspective, started as a symbolic effort. And at the time, we thought that basically by putting together a set of logical predicates, you know, a set of if-then-else rules, we could explain a bunch of things. And we did a lot of work in that direction, except that we got overwhelmed by the difficulty of the challenges ahead of us, in the sense that, for one thing, people didn't figure out what was that we should look at as the if part of our rules. Okay, what should we look at as conditions, mm-hmm. Or preconditions for consequence to happen? We also got lost in actually trying to figure out how coherent and complete in their coverage those rules are. And then we had a few theoretical problems where people said, hey, forget it, you'll never be able to get to intelligence going this way. I'm thinking about mathematicians like Gödel, mm-hmm. back in the 30s. Then we had this business of connectionism. And connectionism is very attractive because, for one thing, it puts us in a somewhat familiar setting, because when we look at this business of neurons, mm-hmm. we think of our brain and we say, hey, we're close to the real thing, you know? I mean, we're intelligent, so if we can figure out how these things can be put together, we'll have intelligence. But I think the other thing that happened also, and that's where actually the caveat of this whole business falls, in my opinion. At one point, we had a specific model of neural networks that was put together, the so-called convolutional neural mm-hmm. networks. And that settled a big issue that we had to deal with, which was, what should we look at in terms of features in order to be able to infer things about intelligence? And those models actually solved the problem for us by basically sending the question under the rug, in the sense that they will figure out features for us, except that those features are theirs, they're not ours, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. So yes, one of those networks, and those are the most popular ones, by the way, when you look at all the Star Wars stories.
what the science fiction is feeding us as an idea.
That cover the whole field. They relate to these convolutional mm-hmm. networks mm-hmm. and variations thereof. Yes, they have kind of solved a problem for us in the sense that they figure out things that would allow them to learn. And again, learn in their own way, not mm-hmm. not in a way that makes sense to us. But there is no way that we can explain those things. And the whole process is very mechanical. When you look at the so-called the artificial general intelligence, which is an attempt to mimic or at least reproduce mm-hmm. what we as human beings can do, as far as I know, there is no way that with the tools that we're using today, we'll be able to reproduce things like emotions, like opinions. You know, there is a bunch of things that are specific to human beings.
Could you say, Munir, because in the same sense, some researchers have said about that we still, as you were saying, do not know how every function of the brain, you know, when you're talking emotion, exactly like that, works. So trying to mimic that into AI is something different, and that's why some researchers have more concentrated on saying machine learning or deep learning when they wanted to address the specific idea of the computer learning and from example or from other ways.
Well, here you're asking a question that relates to, I think, to another question that's coming, okay. The connection between neurosciences and computer science.
Do you want us to go to the other questions?
Oh, it's up to you. I can answer.
Yes.
I can answer in either setting.
You wanted to.
If you look at actually the whole field,
yes.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yes, I have Catherine and then Jim. Yes.
Kristen.
Oh, sorry.
That's all right. I just want to say, as a machine learning researcher, I think neural nets or deep learning is terribly far from general intelligence, because, you know, if you've ever solved a real problem, all it does is solve the middle. It just does in versus out in a fancy way that's very powerful and great. Mm-hmm. But humans set up the problem. They translate the world into some task that's mapped to some machine learning algorithm, and they figure out the data, and then they have to also take the outputs. So the real cognitive process is either end, and the stuff in the middle, yeah, we're doing well on that, but we need cognitive science and think about how do we represent our design, how do we map a problem. I mean, you could ask a child to predict the weather tomorrow, but you can't ask a neural net to do that, right? Or, you know, is the stock going to go up? Well, it went up yesterday. I think it's going to go up tomorrow. So it doesn't even have the most rudimentary skills at doing prediction and understanding of its environment, or how to set up a problem and how to change data into insight. It just does a mechanical process.
Thank you. Jim, you wanted to bounce on this? No, so we'll go then to the next question. The current reshaping of the AI landscape is also impacting its relationship to cognitive sciences. And the first question on that subject is, how do you see the role of cognitive sciences in the context of the almost total dominance of connectionism in the field? We were starting a bit on connectionism with you, so we're back to this. So let me repeat this. How do you see the role of cognitive sciences in the context of the almost total dominance of connectionism in the field? So we're sort of bouncing on what you were saying, Christine.
So I'm going to use that question to get back to an assumption you made in an earlier question that I decided I'd wait till now to fight, which was the notion of AGI as the goal of artificial intelligence. So the idea is that what artificial intelligence is about is building an intelligent machine that's like a human intelligence. And that would be like saying that the goal of aeronautics engineering is to build an airplane that's as close to a bird as possible, as opposed to looking at other skills, other things they do, things like that. So, and I think that when you come to cognitive science, we see that same kind of question. So there's one branch of AI which is really looking primarily at performance and operation, at, you know, the metrics would be speed, would be quality of evaluation, you know, is it getting the picture, you know, is it recognizing the images right? Things like that, the kind of issues that Kristen brought up or I brought up in my talk today about how we really do stuff with that, how we set it up, how we understand it, that's really right now still more the realm of the cognitive. Now, I used to use this analogy a lot, and you know, that the applied AI was a lot like air, you know, building airplanes, not so much like studying birds. And one of the people I knew who was a very famous aeronautics engineer said, but you know, we still have parts of the community that study birds because there are many things that the birds can do that we don't know how to do with airplanes, aircraft, helicopters, et cetera yet, right? A bird can, you know, fly, land on something like this, move to this orientation, fly off, do something different. You know, again, that kind of versatility, that kind of agility. So we can build an airplane that can fly from, you know, here to Europe in a few hours, but, you know, to do this very agile stuff. I think it's the same analogy in a sense with AI. We know how to do many of these hard problems and already have superhuman capabilities, but in these fairly narrow areas. And I think that's fine. I think that's great. I think that should be a goal of part of this. But I think when we start to say that replaces cognitive science, that's the right way to understand what people do, that's like saying airplanes are the right way to understand what birds do. It's exactly backwards.
I actually started my talk on this, but you were listening in English.
He put up all these slides that were pictures with no conclusions on them. We had to guess what he was saying.
There's two motivations. Never mind what it is that they're doing. There's two motivations. One is to make useful tools for human beings. That's one. And the other one is to figure out how human beings' heads work. And they're distinct. Some of the things the bird analogy is pretty good. I mean, we want an airplane to carry us where we're going, but there are also those biologists among us who really want to know how a bird does what it does. Maybe it'll turn out to be useful for some applied reason, but they're still separated. One is for a useful tool, the other is to reverse engineer nature, right? Reverse engineer a bird and figure out how it is that it flies rather than producing something that carries you.
So we're agreeing, so I'm going to change my opinion.
Actually, I agree too with what you said.
That's very bad. Can you help?
So we have a problem because we all agree.
No, but you have to look also at the history of things because they teach us a lot. You know, this business of trying to understand cognition, or at least this part of what we call intelligence, because one of the big issues about intelligence is that a lot of people talk about it, but nobody has defined it yet, okay? So actually, we know it through properties, through what we think it's not,
but we don't know exactly
what it does, actually. Also.
Okay? Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we have one example of intelligence, and that's human intelligence. Mm-hmm. I'm sure Etienne will also tell me about animal intelligence. But anyways, there is the human one that we're familiar with and that there is a consensus on. And that intelligence actually has been studied for quite a while. I mean, it goes way, way back before we started talking about robots and mm-hmm. what we can do with them and so on. And people study it with other tools, actually, than the ones we use today, because a lot of people today say that, you know, this business of intelligence that we're talking about is a misnomer, actually. And they're not, you know, small gamers. I mean, big shots from Intel and big companies mm-hmm. say, hey, what you call artificial intelligence is really a business of algorithms, and it has nothing to do with the real McCoy, you know?
Well, then I think,
so if you look at it now from the neuroscience perspective, neuroscience takes it from, you know, the hypothesis that, well, intelligence is, in between quotes, human, and we should look at that intelligence at least to get some idea about what the artificial one should be or can be or can use or whatever we want to describe the knowledge we extract from one to help the other. So in that perspective, I think that if we're after that business of general intelligence, we really should listen seriously to what the people from neuroscience have to tell us. Because now we're seeing the whole process as minimizing mathematical functions, and I don't think that our brain does that.
I think Jim wanted to bounce on this.
Well, so there's a lot in there I would respond to, but let me just do the simple one, which is that, so first of all, we're very far from understanding the neuroscience. And we say, you know, these deep neural nets look like the brain. Well, they have a very surface relation to certain parts. And it's really, to me, a big part of the problem is that we use these magical words like intelligence, learning, et cetera, the ones we can't define, for these techniques, right? If instead of deep learning, this had been called highly multidimensional, manifold, you know, convergence, right? It would be doing the same thing, but people wouldn't be thinking somehow it was a step to this magical thing we do as people called intelligence. And, you know, I often do things like, say to my audience, you know, supposing I told you someone was a great doctor and had learned how to do all sorts of diagnosis and, you know, was able to do things better than any other doctor in the world, do you think that person could learn to tie their shoes? You know, most people would look at me like I'm silly and say, of course, right? But the deep learning system can learn to do the doctor thing. No one has got one yet that can learn to tie its shoes, and certainly you would have to train it separately to do all these different tasks. You don't get this kind of learning of this implies learning how to do other. So again, many things we do as humans and we use in terms like learning and artificial intelligence and things like that really are very loaded terms.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And if you sort of pull them away and just go to the technical meaning, I think a lot of these questions we're discussing sort of become much easier because you're saying, you know, is this something the brain does mathematically? Okay, that's a good question in terms of brains. It's not necessarily the right question in terms of behaviors or other things.
Stephen, you wanted to say something?
I am a bad professor. I say things that you're not supposed to say, especially to students, okay? And one of the things that I say often is that most fields, in fact, all fields of academic fields, are mostly pygmies. I'm a pygmy, mm-hmm. okay, and Jim's a pygmy. There are a few giants, like Alan Turing. And Alan Turing in 1950 did set the agenda for what eventually would become both artificial intelligence and cognitive science. What he said was, to answer the question, what is intelligence? He said, I'm not going to define intelligence. Intelligence is as intelligence does, or better still, intelligence is as intelligence can do. Okay, and it's the can-do, the capacity to do the things that intelligent systems can do that we're trying to explain. We're trying to reverse engineer it. And the Turing test is saying, what you're trying to do is come up with a causal explanation of what it is that we can do. Okay? And for that, you can't avoid turning to the discipline of artificial intelligence computation, because if you're asking neuroscience, I mean, neuroscience measures what's active in the brain when you're doing it, but it doesn't give you a mechanism for anything cognitive. Mm-hmm. As far as I know, tell me if you know differently, not one non-trivial cognitive capacity has been learned, how it works has been learned from neuroscience. Neuroscience follows reverse engineering by computer science and robotics.
I'm not sure about that.
Do you want me to add a little bit to this question, or you'd rather fight a bit about that? Because I wanted to.
No, because I've done things with neuroscience the other way. You know, I've been able to embed cognitive abilities in robots starting from neuroscience principles.
Could you sing a hum a few bars?
Well, I've implemented classical conditioning, operant conditioning, habituation in a robot.
Classical conditioning and operant conditioning are not neuroscience, right?
Okay. They're cognitive principles
but they're cognitive principles that are inhuman.
But we're not arguing human versus cognitive.
I didn't implement them by minimizing, an error function or doing a gradient descent. I implemented a spiking neural network, which is as close as you can get in the metaphor with the biological networks. And I trained it using STDP, as you probably know about. So I did not use backpropagation. And I got that robot, that is, that thing with four wheels, to behave as if it, was conditioned.
So we were discussing like cognitive sciences, and the next thing I was about to ask you, and I think it's going to go a bit in that direction, is could cognitive sciences help fill possible gaps in exclusive data and learning-driven approach to artificial intelligence? Is there like a, if we say like a cognitive science, could they help us fill the possible gap in exclusive data and learning-driven approach in AI?
Well, I have a question for these guys.
Yes.
Can you help with causality? Because, all that deep learning stuff doesn't do causality. And if we need it bad for all these applications, and if you're going to explain or do anything, you need causality. So and we don't even get to talk about it in statistics. So
I actually think you're reducing it to something that gives you an output from an input is understating what that actually is. In a way, we can talk about everything. Physics, Newtonian mechanics is giving an output from an input. Causality is what comes in between.
Right.
And that's what we're trying. And algorithms can provide causality. Neural nets as feature filters can provide causality. It's not just.
No, they provide correlation.
They're just correlative. That's I don't think they find causality.
If they generate performance, then it's causality. If it's just something that's going on in the brain and something else is going on that you're doing, then it's correlation. You know, I think of my grandmother and this area lights up, that's correlation. But if you have a mechanism that does what otherwise I don't know how I do it, that's causality. AI has given some little toy examples of that.
There's an example I saw not long ago about a graph that plotted the chocolate consumption per Nobel Prize numbers for different countries. And you know what country turned out to be the one with the highest number of Nobel Prizes based on that? Switzerland. Okay? Because it turned out that, if you plotted that, it turns out that a lot of people who have Nobel Prizes eat a lot of chocolate in Switzerland. Okay? So is that causality? If I train a neural network to do that, it will exactly give me that result.
Based on
the points that I'm giving it.
I don't understand.
It will tell me if you eat a lot of chocolate, you're going to get a lot of Nobel Prizes.
I vote in favor of that.
That's correlation. That's not causality.
But when you think about the human mind, we can make causal models. I mean, that's what mathematicians do mm-hmm. when they do applied mathematics. That's what engineers do when they do industrial manufacturing and they design systems. They're mm-hmm. making causal models. They have all kinds of way to reason about that, but we can't do that.
You have a causal model if you have something that works and does something. If you start at time one, there's something in nature that's doing this, but I don't know how. So I'm going to build a gadget that does it, and then at least I have one hunch as to how, and that's causality.
But if you can't extrapolate out of the space where it was taught, effectively.
I agree.
Yeah, so that's not causal.
The disappointment of classical AI was that it was just a bunch of toy models, and to a certain extent, this is true also in connectionism, that you have something that does a particular thing, but it doesn't generalize to everything.
So if you have a causal model, you can ask, and I'm borrowing this from Judea Pearl, this is not original, but you can ask, say, for you, if I give you a drug, what's going to happen to you? Because I have a model for that. But I can take a situation right now and say, I want to manipulate it, and what will happen? So you can't do that with a neural net. You can't say, it doesn't know how to change something about the world.
I'm not sure how that's related to... Right, I mean, pharmacology, right, which is not cognitive science, but pharmacology, even if we're not talking about cognitive function, but just liver function, I mean, pharmacology can be modeled computationally.
Sure.
So what Kristen's saying is generating that model, right, is the cognitive aspect of this thing that's missing from these kind of network models and things like that.
Yep. Let's
just say... We see high correlation between when you give this to what happens here, but that doesn't give you a model in the middle that says how it's happening, I think.
If you're asking about causality, the way to make it substantive is to say, is there something that we don't know how to do, and then you come into the room and give me something that does it. You've got a causal model.
Well, a big example, counterexample with this is I could make a system that can drive my car, but it can't necessarily extrapolate to new situations. And I need to know that it doesn't apply.
I agreed on that one. I agree that a lot of these causal models are toy causal models, local toy causal models. I agree.
So you have local causality, I guess, is your argument.
Well, yeah, you asked about causality. You didn't say if it had to be everything. The Turing test, the total Turing test, requires something to be basically you. I mean, one of us sitting here would have to be the candidate that passed the Turing test and can do everything that a human can do. We're nowhere near that.
No.
But the neural net is, the deep learning is lacking common sense. Like, we know that if I let go of this bottle, it's going to drop, but it doesn't know that, you know? It doesn't have these notions of the world and how cause and effect works in the
world. So that's one of the Google things. I'm not talking about Google, the web, but the... 10 to the 100th things that it can't do. It can do one thing, the toy thing, and then all the rest it can't do, and then among other things it can't tell you about the laws of mechanics. But that's what we're trying to head for. That's what Turing suggested we should head for. Get something that can do it all. Once you've got something that can do it all, one explanation.
So...
And we're still in very specific models and just adapted to one thing. And now if we want, because I know that Kristen is specializing in predictive data also. So now that artificial intelligence is, I would say, surely making its way into what we call now the industry 4.0 and the manufacturing 4.0, what are the specific challenges for the AI researcher and practitioners related to that context? And I guess we'll be talking a bit about predictive analysis in this question.
Do you want to start?
I think that I think that the challenges of the artificial intelligence or the cognitive sciences that we have spoke tomorrow this morning is a good basis for the industry of the future. And for manufacturing 4.0 point of view, mm-hmm. the cognitive science helps in improve the cognition of the machine. and the interaction between the machine and the operators in the industry. Because now the machine, the purpose of the machine does not belong on itself, but depends on the purpose of the operators does to the machine.
The input
is not conscientious, is not intelligent in itself, but we put artificial intelligence in many forms: neural network for predictive something, or for decision making, fuzzy, neurofuzzy, and genetic algorithm, and so on. But the machine tool with artificial intelligence is not creative for the moment. And I think the cognitive science could help in this sense, because there is the risk that artificial intelligence could overtaking over the man. Is a risk. There is an old film on the robot that you know.
The fact that we're afraid that they will take over.
The cognitive science, I think that we could have a good cooperation between the natural intelligence, as in the operator, the human intelligence, and the artificial intelligence.
And we are probably, as we speak right now, building these models, because I know that in some industry they're already integrating. And I'm addressing to Christine, because I know you probably know a lot about that. We're already integrating at least components of AI to manage a lot of things in the process chain.
Yes. So, I mean, you really need AI, and you need symbolic AI, and you need to represent the domain to deal with industry at the scale you did, at the massive scale. Because I work in the semiconductor industry, and we're working with a global, with global foundries, and they have this digital foundry, right, that is solving. It's when you make a wafer, semiconductor wafer, it goes through 100 process steps and 100 different machines. It travels 5 miles. I mean, the building is bigger than a football field, and it's full of all these machines, and it's amazingly complex. And so you have to manage that complexity and make it efficient to figure out what's going on and how to schedule and how to do quality control. And so AI could really help with that process and make it so that people don't have so much trouble. And I'll give an example. When I started in there, I met with a guy, and he actually makes the machines. He's an engineer on the machine. And when they have a fault and they can't find it, it takes him a week to analyze the data. And then he does this representation, and it's so awkward. And then he tries to figure out what's going on. And I gave it to my undergrads, and they found the error, and you know, PCA ran it. It's obvious, you know. So it's this huge, time-consuming process. So we could use that automation to do that. And what we really need to do, though, is make it so that engineer is part of the partnership, and we need to know it so that the deep learning systems and all that, no baby engineering, right? These are all man-made constructs. The whole machine is made in men's and women's heads.
We hope so.
Yes, and so we know a lot about what's going on. We know that there's a control system. We know how control systems work. We have models that can totally model how they work, and we need to apply and build in all that engineering knowledge. So we need this intersection between the symbolic and the cognitive, and also just, you know, machine learning predictive. We need both.
You need both so that you can perform more complex tasks.
Yeah, because you have to solve you have to do a lot of tasks. Actually, it's not so much, you have to do a lot of not so complex tasks. but they're kind of time-consuming mm-hmm. and tedious, and you do them over and over and over
like
again.
Like reviewing data and finding problems yeah. in data sets.
Every time I
like
find
that.
An error, well, the machine can flag it, and then I have to decide what to do. It can help me decide my decision-making. It can help me decide, well, where might the problem be, and then I might decide as a technician, what do I need to do? And maybe I could reduce the skill level of somebody who needs to do that process. Mm-hmm. Maybe I don't have to pay the fancy engineer or take a week, you know, when I'm making semiconductor wafers that cost $5,000 a piece and everybody's screaming at me, right? So.
Yeah, so we still need a combination of human and technologies right,
yes.
to do so.
And we're oh, yes, yeah, go ahead. Excuse me.
So we're going to discuss a recent trend in the field, explainable AI, which we call XAI. It seems to gain right now a lot of traction, driven by new legislation and regulations in terms of privacy, data protection, and the right to an explanation for an algorithmic decision. It's kind of transparency, we could say. So we're also thinking about the RGPD in the General Data Protection Regulation in Europe. So of course this is all like linked together. So wouldn't this finally warrant a more balanced approach towards AI systems where symbolic and connectionism components coexist and collaborate to achieve higher explainability? That's a complex question. Would you like me to yes? Would you like me to repeat
actually,
it? Okay.
That's the way it's done today. Because if you look at those neural networks, they're inherently correlation machines, despite what mm-hmm. Has been said.
yes.
There is no way that you can explain causality in those things. Okay, you can do it in the machine way. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I have an input here, goes through a layer, I get an output from that layer, gets me another output and so on. And the only way I can explain that is, well, I'm multiplying a matrix by a vector, mm-hmm. which means absolutely nothing to a human being, okay? Today, what people are doing actually is going back to that symbolic approach. That is, you have that neural network that's a black box.
Yes.
And what we build are surrogate models around it where we try to explain what it's doing through those models, knowing that those models are not as precise, but are explainable, and the black box is not explainable, but is precise. And we try to combine the two. That's how it's been done today.
So you cannot see the steps that led to an algorithmic decision.
Yeah, it's a mix of something that you can explain, but that's not a neural network, mm-hmm. and a neural network that you cannot explain, but that brings you coffee to bed.
I think that's a tremendous oversimplification of the current state of things. There's a lot of people looking at how we model what's going on inside the networks, how to build networks with pieces in it.
Try to visualize.
Things like that. No, not computational. In other words, we take the output of the network and we're looking mm-hmm. at things. You also have ways to manipulate, like you could with any black box, right? So if I need for example, years ago, right, insurance companies started using neural networks to make decisions. Would I insure someone? Would I not insure someone? Or would I give a bank loan, right? One of the things they can do is you can permute the inputs. Right, yeah. So you can change. So I can say, if you know, this is what the person put in, and it said, don't give them a loan. And I'd say, okay, now I increase the amount of income. Would they have gotten the loan? And if the answer is yes, that's not really the explanation, but it is an explanation that fits the legal definition, certainly of the GDPR. And so many of the things people are looking at now include both that, how do you explain what's happening, not so much by going inside the box, but by doing it. The other is to actually look inside and see if you can extract features. But what I would say is that there's some really good cognitive evidence that, so if you ask people a question, you will often get an answer faster. So you ask a question, you get the answer, you ask them, please explain that answer. They give you the explanation. First of all, in terms of just mental time it takes to do things, right? They could not have generated that answer by that process, right? So we know we have these much faster processes that are getting us to decisions, and different. Again, this symbolic model is what we use to approximate it in today's thing. So there is a notion of this hybrids, but that's not the same as necessarily explaining what's going on within the neural network, but rather it's a way of reconstructing things like that, testing. But so again, we need a lot of stuff we don't know how to do yet, but that's not, you know, again, one of the talks I give is just the opposite of the one I talked today. Today I talked about why neural network people need to understand traditional AI. I also have a talk about why traditional AI people have to start paying attention. So for example, almost all of our models start with a logical sentence, which is true or false, start with a probability. So if you take the outputs of a neural net and treat them like they're probabilities, you get horrible things happen because it's not a probability. It's a complex combination of many different distributions, many different things, many different features that aren't nameable, partial features, etc. Especially when you start using the CNNs and RNNs and things like that, adversarial training. So again, many of the things we're talking about doing with these neural nets are giving us outputs that we really should be looking at as how would we use that as an input to a symbolic device? And I have seen almost no good research in that area. The symbolic people prefer to ignore the neural nets, and I think that's as big a mistake as the neural nets people ignoring the symbolic.
May I ask you another question? Maybe Jim or Kristen or maybe Munir would have an answer to this, because when we look at predictive AI and all that and algorithms, could we figure out, because I'm trying to see this, at least what since we asked the question, we want the AI to solve something, like you were talking about finding like errors and things like that. So is there in the idea of explainable AI some criteria that could be transparent about how we reach an algorithmic decision?
Well, the one approach you haven't covered yet for how you get an explainable decision is they actually constrain the deep learning models to be explainable. So they actually structure them so that you can interpret and see each part by restricting them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if in Canada they have FICO scores, but you know, this is who gets FICO scores in the United States. That's if you get a loan, you get a score. And if you have good credit or bad credit.
Yes, we do.
Well, it's all done with neural nets now. I had breakfast with the guy who does it. So, and they use these additive models. So they're restrained to have this metaphor that everything has to increase your risk. So you have these things that
fire. I was thinking
fire.
About those bank operations where they make your credit or they give you credit with using algorithms.
So each one of the thing it adds, it can be nonlinear and funky, but it's got to increase your risk. They have to be additive models, so they're based on kind of linear additive. You get this risk factor, you know, you don't pay your bills on time, and it builds up these features slowly.
So these features could be what would make it more transparent in this specific case.
Yeah, so that's how they make explainable models, but still use deep learning. So they actually restrict them. And I don't know if there's any other metaphors besides linear additivity that cognitive science could offer us machine learning researchers so we could have other modes of explainability, but I'd be interested in knowing if there was.
But don't you think that all of these explanation processes happen post hoc? That is, they're built after we see what the network has done. And then we try to go back and try to figure out how it's doing it. We don't have a mechanism today that allows us to say, this is exactly what's happening in this network at this particular moment, and this is why it's doing this and not that. Okay?
What we have are,
as you said, constraints that allow us to kind of build another model, actually, that is explaining what's going on.
I mean, there's two fields, right? There's the people like Line who are doing what you said, which is probably closer to what people do, right? They can't explain what they did. Mm-hmm. They do it afterwards. They don't know. They don't go through that process. But there are also these ones that do these, I wouldn't even call them deep, but they're kind of shallower networks that are explainable.
Yeah.
You want to add something, Stephen?
If I were in the audience now, I'd be starting to get frustrated.
Okay, let's go forward.
Okay. Yes. are you people frustrated? So we'll go.
So if you have questions or comments or want to join in the conversation.
Yeah, we have one. Actually, we have one last question, and then we can take questions from the if you want. So
can we just set it up.
Another somewhat related trend is human-in-the-loop machine learning and the AI that looks at way human agents and artificial agents can collaborate solving complex problems. So we're following here in the same way. How do you see the role of cognitive sciences in this context?
Yes.
Doriana?
So the problem in manufacturing industry 4.0, the man in the loop, is a big problem because we have to control the operators and in particular the we now to control, for example, the workload of the operator. And we need to take under control this workload to avoid some errors during the manufacturing process or during the processing in industry or, for example, the pilot of the aereo and we have to take under control and cognitive science could help to take under control the workload of the operators in the loop and the man in the loop. The man in the loop is not only we can view the man and the operator in the loop as an opposite point, but we have to view the operator and the man as integrated, as a real integration in the loop. In many points, for example, manufacturing processes, in many points, the start point is for the decision of the variable of the manufacturing process and the man can decide in that point. But the man, we can have the man in the loop also for in the control loop to avoid some error because yes, we have artificial intelligence for the decision making, but it's not enough now.
So we're still working with a human and artificial intelligence model.
Yes, because in some cases we have the decision made by artificial intelligence, but the operators use that decision only as a support. Mm-hmm. The final decision as of the operator and the man. We need the man for the moment, but the cognitive science could avoid these this presence, and I think that in manufacturing for 5.0, we can help an amended.
Or people are already scared of 4.0, yes. Diana, so this is a big thing they're getting us to work with. Would you like us to take a question from the audience?
Because
I think like the audience is probably like there were lots of little things you know left out. So I think we already have someone standing at the microphone. So you may formulate your question.
Yes, thank you for the very interesting debate. I love when you don't agree. So I'll just ask a question where I think you won't agree. There was a talk about causality and correlation, but nobody actually talked about the fact that humans are very bad at noting the difference, and we have invented fancy mental tools called science to make sure that we don't mistake correlation for causality. So my question comes, why are you using such an idealized version of human thoughts to say what we should do with AI? Why aren't we going back in the evolution, looking at smaller and more simple organisms to try to understand what could be made intelligent at some point. So the question as to why are humans being idolized and why humans are still models?
That's a pretty good question. So anybody would like to
start?
Oh, we have Jim and Munir.
So
no, actually. Oh, go ahead.
You go first.
Well, I think the reason we do that is simply because we know how we have an idea of the consequences of a human being making a mistake. We don't doubt a machine. Right now, we know that they can be wrong, but we don't know how wrong they can be and what the consequences of that would be. So I think we're just trying to be maybe cautious and, you know, by saying, hey, if it's causal, I know that the risks of things going sour is limited.
So I want to address the second half of your question, mm-hmm. sort of the animal. So there was a really good article in the communications of the ACM, I think a few months or a year ago, called, you know, are we building animal AI or human AI? And there's a lot of discussion there. My personal anecdote on this is I've known Jan LeCun, who was the one who came up with convolutional neural nets and quite well known. And we were having a debate on Facebook about something. And I said, well, you know, if you could do that, you know, that's the kind of thing you could train your dog to do. And he said, you look, if I could get my AI as good as my dog, I would declare success and go home. Right? So in other words, there's a lot of things we still don't know how to do, these very basic things. Right? So again, this is where you start confusing some of this human capability playing Go, right? Seems like a very hard, very human thing. Only humans have ever done it. You can't really train a pigeon to play Go. You can train a pigeon to find breast tumors, but let's not go there. But finding these differences, understanding them, is important. I think where we keep going back to is this kind of thing we call reasoning, symbolics, causality. It goes by a lot of different names, but it's the thing we believe that we do differently than all those other entities. So again, the cognitive scientist, particularly studying the human cognition system, is really interested primarily in those things that are different between humans and the other entities. But of course, you may need to understand what we're built on top of to get there.
We will. No, no, it's just that Stephen had something planned and he asked me if you could leave a little bit before the end. Yeah. So this is not about you.
That's okay. We're not offended, Stephen. We'll see you at the next thing. We'll remember.
So do we have another question from the audience? Oh, de l'autre côté. Oh, oui, pardonnez-moi, j'avais pas vu qu'il y avait un autre micro. Allez-y.
Yes, in order to answer, to ask my question, I think I have to present myself at least as an industrial mechanical engineer. So as engineers, we look for solutions, direct solutions, more than thinking of very basic questions. I have been working on I'm professor at Ecole Polytechnique, so I have been working on maintenance fault diagnosis and prognosis since 2009. And I have been using machine learning in order to arrive to detect faults and predict also faults. My question is the following. We arrived now, we know how to do all these things, fault diagnosis, prognosis, and so on, and decision making. But we are at a step where we would like to introduce what is called a self-healing equipment, which means that we would like, or we call it also autonomous maintenance, which means that we would like the machine to take to detect its status, maybe also predicted, and then decide what to do. And now my question after, that's why I'm here now today to hear you. My question is the following, two things. Why you only talk about deep learning and neural network, although neural network, it has been known for many, many years. I know it has been developed, but at a certain time, it just went down and it was not used at all because of this, what you are talking about now, about the black box situation. Mm-hmm. And why are you talking about only deep learning and not about, for example, support vector machine or any other methods? Second, why aren't you talking about pattern recognition? Because in my mind, the next step that I will take in my research, it will pattern recognition is very interesting because in my mind, we can just, at least in pattern recognition, we can put a list without going into causal or correlation. We can go into a list of possible way to possible reasons or causes of a certain phenomena, and maybe this is what will give me the self-healing equipment.
Thank you. Well, I think so, Jim, our semantic person,
well,
already had answers.
I'll take the second part. And
okay,
then,
so
then
first part
Kristen.
Will be Kristen and
you
then Jim.
I was going to do it the other direction.
Would you like to go, Kristen?
I don't care.
I'm going to throw it over to you.
Okay.
Okay.
So let me answer your second question first, in a sense. The capabilities of the neural nets now with these deep learning, they're a quick history lesson, right? They were being done in a certain way. Someone came along and proved that they couldn't do what they were being claimed to do. Mm-hmm. Analysis went into that, and sure enough, they couldn't do what they were being claimed to do, and people found out what they were doing. Went away for a while, but you know, there was still a community working on it. Turned out, but the people who proved that the two-layer networks couldn't do things hypothesized that a three-layer network couldn't. Later, people actually proved the three-layer networks could do these things. Now, there was a proof that a three-layer network can do anything a multi-layer network can do. But it's based on the assumption, it's mathematically provable, it just assumes that it's fully connected. What hadn't been looked at was these things like these partially connected. So these things we've been talking about, CNNs, RNNs. So there's been a lot of mathematical change in the models and things like that. So the capabilities of what they do has grown. But I think what really impressed people and pulled them back to the deep learning was the pattern recognition they do, the ability to recognize objects in video, and most importantly, go. So the reason we hypothesized that humans would outperform computers in Go for many years to come was because Go is played by humans as a complex pattern recognition system. What the computer did was actually found a way of doing a certain level of pattern recognition coupled with certain other kinds of computation. That pulled a lot of the attention over to deep learning because it was doing this thing that had been hypothesized to be impossible. So it's not so much that the other models were being ignored as that this model suddenly showed capability that hadn't been expected. So I think that's what raised so much of the attention to those systems. And Kristen can talk about the other models. She helped invent SVM.
Yeah. So I worked on support vector machines before they existed. I called them neural nets at the beginning. It's marketing. It's just it's just a less complex function than a neural net. You're just fitting a bunch of parameters to a kind of a universal approximator. So things haven't changed. So what's the real answer to your question? It's like when you buy real estate, they say location, location, location. Well, when you're doing real machine learning, it's representation, representation, representation. So if you have a good representation to your model, then you can do anything with a linear model, and it's great, it's interpretable, and it's wonderful, and it works 80% of the time. You know, it's great. And support vector machines took that up a notch, right? They still give you nice convex models, but they had a little bit more complexity and could model nonlinearity in a certain way, kind of in a nearest neighbor way. And I think the big innovations with the deep learning was that they really cracked some of the representation issues, especially for things like video and images and things like that, because we didn't have good representations for those things. So suddenly it was learning the representation. Now you could ask, is that enough? No, it's not enough, because they're really good at images and speech and things that have kind of the structured data. But if you take medical data that's kind of a mix of stuff and of categorical and continuous variables, they're not so hot at that, right? So, there's still lots of representation issues left. And I think for your question, so about making a self-healing manufacturing or something like that, right, or self-helping thing, it's also a representation. We don't collect, you need to collect the data about What do you do? What's the process? Mm-hmm. How did you discover that fault? What was the result? And you need to represent all that. And then you can make a system that would learn to do that. But you have to decide to capture that information. And so you really need to capture that whole end-to-end process, not just the middle of where you predict, I've got a fault. But you've got to say, how did you figure out that you had a fault? What was the method you used? What was the resolution to the problem? And then you could make a system that would learn, what should I do next for dealing with this problem? It's kind of almost like reinforcement learning. And there is a lot of, there is some effort in that regard that we need to start thinking about, I mean, reinforcement learning type solutions where we try to navigate that state space. But, you know, really, I guess as you're way ahead of us here, you should collect that data and then maybe you could make the system learn to decide what to do with the information that I got when I found that fault and found this pattern. Now I have to decide, what do I do? You know, so it need, you have to represent that problem.
Any other question from the audience?
Please.
Please. We want questions.
and this being a panel, comments are fine too.
Yes, comments.
Normally
questions.
We say, don't get up and make a comment.
We have one on this and one on this side. You can use the microphone right there.
Fine. Even though I can't speak loud.
Oh, yes, I see you have
the
right voice.
Yeah, but it doesn't get on the recording unless you have.
Yes.
That's
good. We was.
Yes, so we've talked a lot about the kind of the limits of either symbolic or deep learning connectionist models to model some of the more sophisticated aspects of the human mind, like you know, the more flexibility, more working different tasks. And I want to know, with this regard, could solutions like some cognitive architectures that try to model things on a more biologically plausible could be a way to help with that respect.
So anybody has an input on that idea of modeling? If I understood you correctly, architecture that is
biological.
Organic.
Yeah, well, but there's a few proposals, at least that I know of, like the neural engineering framework mm-hmm. with the what is it called, the SPON architecture and the Libra and such models, and they try to kind of bundle like things down to the neuron mechanics and start from there to try and come up with cognitive modeling. So could this kind of approach be a viable solution? To break the limits of more traditional AI approaches for human mind modeling.
Thank you.
So there's a lot of work going on looking at different models, many of them based on looking at, rather than the neuron just as a connective model, you also have spiking, things like that. One of the things that I think is actually very interesting, and we're in the very early days of, is so it turns out that actually modeling these neural nets takes a huge amount of computation, right? And it's pretty clear that it can't be a model of what's going on in the brain. A colleague of mine once said, just to physically have the amount of connections that some of these systems have, you'd have to have a head the size of a bathtub, right? And we don't. And our energy consumption is very small and things like that. So people are actually now moving back to analog models. And they're actually studying analog models from two directions. One is, can we build analog models where we take the computation we want to do in these neural networks and things like that and make them faster? But the other one that I think is very interesting is people who are actually looking at analog models of some of the brain mechanisms, saying, you know, can we build a component in here that can do a set of these kind of, I'm going to use the word computation, but I'm putting it in quote, you know, in a material so that, you know, again, as the stuff flows through the material, whether it spikes or not, right? Because we happen to know that, you know, like the stuff inside here is not a lot of ones and zeros in any, in the mechanical sense. So I think both sides of that conversation are happening. I think they haven't quite made conversation with each other yet, but I think that's an area that there's a lot of interest right now. And a lot of the architectures you mentioned, and also some of the cognitive architectures, the A-stars and things like that, are starting to come together precisely because people are saying, hey, if we're going to have this thing which we think is a good model of the thinking, and this thing which is a good model of the brain computation, then if you could bring them together, maybe you could explain a lot of things. And a lot of the people who are doing that are moving down from human, from this complex human symbolic stuff to, again, what other intelligent entities, but at a lesser level of intelligence, or however you want to use that term, would do.
Thank you, Jim.
Do you want to?
Bonjour, hi.
Bonjour.
Mon nom est Jean. Je suis I'm a graduate from LUCAM 30 years ago. So, I think we're at a place where we still have a long way to go before we understand a little bit more about this field of AI. So, how do you feel about the progression we've made since the 60s and the 70s up to now? And how do you feel about what's going to happen in the next 15, 20 years, especially with all the investment, money from, people pouring money in this? So do you expect that we're going to progress? We're going to find something? We're going to achieve something more? Open question.
So where we were and where are we going, basically?
I'm just trying to let other people talk.
I think Munir is like ready for an answer.
Sorry. Well, I'm an optimist.
Well, I'm an
optimist. Yeah, again, I'm an optimist. I think
Kristen,
we'll
you
get
go.
Something new.
That's you. You're in charge.
I guess I'm not. I don't have anything too profound to say, but I guess it's hard to anticipate. Mm-hmm. I mean, having lived through the decline of neural nets and to know that they were to come back, that was a bit of a surprise. But pretty predictably, every few years, there's something that's a game changer. You know, we had convex optimization, we had boosting, and then we had graphical models, and now neural nets are back. So I'm confident, but you just never know quite what it's going to be. So I don't have a prediction.
Because you're also relying on, I would say, computer development, because when you get like the supercomputer and when you'll get the quantum computer, there's like you're anticipating, I guess, what will happen from there.
Yeah, that was certainly.
I think we're going to see a lot of changes over the next years, but you know. Here's my prediction. You can, and almost all my predictions in the past were wrong. So I beta tested Facebook and said nobody's ever going to use this.
And
thing.
Now you're discussing science and not right. Facebook.
But
I may still be right.
Yeah, I may still be right.
Yeah, but it took him like a few years to be right on this one.
But now I got to remember what I was going to say. No. But here's what I would actually predict. Okay, I think the. So right now, developing these networks still has a certain amount of black art to it. It's still it's very much an early engineering kind of. The way the Wright brothers came up with their wing shape is they put a lot of little things in an air tunnel, and they saw which ones got more rise and things like that, and eventually said, hey, this shape seems to work well, right? So they kind of knew the basic principles, and then they had. Dude, if you talk to someone who's building some of these neural networks, they usually try 8 or 10 different architectural changes and different models before they get it. Or they just take an off-the-shelf, extremely powerful model and just train it up on what they're doing. And it turns out that's often, you know, a tremendous amount of overkill. So I think an engineering discipline around this stuff is going to grow, right? And at some point, those engineers doing that who live in mechanical engineering and electrical engineering departments are going to say, you know, this is great stuff and we understand it, but why are we calling it AI? Mm-hmm. Right? And that's sort of what happened. You know, people make fun of the expert systems of the 80s, right? It's now a standard programming technique used by everybody. You can't write a non-rule-based system almost anymore. They're just not completely separate and they're not being claimed to model, you know, human cognition and things like that. So again, this is where I get this objection I have to using these magic words like learning and things like that. I've been to a lot of talks lately on the optimization mathematically of what the deep models are doing. And, you know, again, these terms I was throwing out like manifold compression, things like that, are things that people are really working on now. And I think, you know, there's no question in my mind that these techniques will be absolutely world-changing, will be used in your car, will be used in your house, will be used in that. We're just going to be saying, but why did we ever think this had something to do with intelligence, right? And I think that's kind of the history of what we tend to see in AI, right? So a lot of what we've been talking about up here, whether we talk about how it would be used in manufacturing, what are some of the different models, et cetera, to me is really just been saying, we have this powerful new technique and these other techniques. I mean, I talked about several in my talk today, not just one. And you know, we need to understand these, we need to use these, we need to deploy these. But I still, you know, often say, let's be careful about what we call them, because in another few years, people are gonna say, but they weren't intelligent. And they're right. They're powerful, they're useful, they do incredible things, but why did we think they were like humans?
It's as if we were setting the expectation with all that lexical field.
Well, all new things start with buzzwords, and then you have to wait until, you know, the dust settles down to see what's really behind it. But still, if you look at the way things have evolved, today, basically, we're driven by technology. You know, science moves very slowly. But each time we have a new idea, usually things start from there and get us to a new step. If you take the example of computers, for instance, you know, the first computer that was built in 1943 required 10 kilowatts of power to run, all right? That was a small, you know, electric station. Today, the, you know, your cell phone is probably about 100,000 times more powerful, and it runs on a small lithium battery that you can recharge. And it's the same thing for the type of complex problems that we could solve, you know, over time. I mean, if you take applications in medicine, for instance, it used to be that you needed to do a lot of analyses and studies to figure out whether given disease is available or not. Let's say, I don't know, somebody would like to see whether you have skin cancer. Today, actually, we already have people who are capable of taking a picture of your skin and tell you whether there's a high chance for you to, you know, have that or not. And that wasn't possible 20 years ago or 30 years ago. It came about because of this business of CNNs and what have you, regardless of whether there is a buzz attached to them or not. So if you look at things, you know, from a distance, we see that actually we're moving forward. We're not going backward. Where we're going, that's another story. But you know, we're going there. So I'm positive, actually. I'm optimistic about things improving. But there is always a limit to where we can go with a given idea. Right now, I would say we're in the era of weak intelligence. We're in the era of pattern recognition. We can recognize patterns very, very nicely. But actually, when we try to be smarter than that, today we're forced actually to go back to science. You know, if you look at that, I don't know, the AlphaGo, you know, the big story about a computer beating a human being in Go, if you look at it up close, actually it's not deep learning that did it, because basically it was a Markov decision process, which is something that you can explain very well, and which is based on statistics. But nobody knew how to deal with those statistics. Nobody knew how to figure them out. And then somebody came and said, hey, by the way, if you do reinforcement learning on those, you can figure out all those things that you need to get the machine working. So the basic machine was there. What we didn't know was how to use it. And then deep learning came to say, hey, I'm here to help. And today, actually,
that notion of reinforcement learning can be used for many things, actually. You were mentioning about self-healing machines that could be probably dealt with using that same paradigm, okay? But when you're doing reinforcement, you're, in my opinion, you're going back to the biology of things. So you're getting away from gradient descent and minimizing quadratic errors and so on.
Do we have one last question from the audience? Yes, please. Because we're getting closer to six, so yep. Take one last question.
A lot of time today you've said that deep learning and AI in general is really good to solve specific problem in a given context. And I would like to know or to feel a bit, where is the state of the art of how to deal with multiple contexts, how to adapt to different contexts, and maybe what are the big problem we try to tackle with AI right now on that?
That's the next
opinion.
Step.
Okay, would you like to let Christine intervene and then you continue?
No, okay.
Okay, we'll just get Christine to talk
about this. I would think that
one.
We need big AI back. You know, we have this targeted thing and we're learning the neural nets, but they have to rediscover the whole world from scratch, from data, which seems crazy, right? Like if you're building an engineering system, we know how to engineer. We have these smart engineers. We can't start from scratch. They have to learn it all from the data. So I think we have to combine our semantics and our analytics mm-hmm. together. And we have to make systems that can seamlessly incorporate the domain knowledge. And they have to be able to do the analytics and do the deep learning or whatever model or statistics or whatever you need to do the job. And they need to represent the domain. And in real life, you know, when you adapt to a new suggestion, well, I do a lot of health data, and you know, we solve the same health problems over and over in different contexts. So if we can capture that semantics of what we need, the domain information mm-hmm. and the logic and the causality and the things that we know, then we can build systems that can jump from different topics and solve different problems in a much more flexible way. And I think that's what we really need. So we need to combine our semantics and our analytics together. So we call that semantalytics.
Thank you, Christine. Munir? Would you like to add something?
No. I was about to say earlier that we're here. We're in the realm of weak intelligence. We need to move to strong intelligence. Mm-hmm. But we haven't been there. One way to do it is what has been suggested. But for now, we're still living off the buzz of that deep learning stuff. We need to, you know, Kurzweil used to say that, you know, knowledge evolves in steps. So at the beginning, there is a new discovery, and then you have a vertical development mm-hmm. of it. And then as basically the thing sinks in and becomes familiar, you know, the rate of growth starts slowing down, and then you hit a plateau where nothing happens. It becomes, you know, nobody, everybody knows that, so there's no novelty in that. And we're waiting for the next new thing to happen so that we climb the next step and move on to the next thing to do. Right now, we're waiting for that to happen. But for that to happen, we have to get rid of what we're doing now. We have to become very good at this weak intelligence thing. And then it is expected from what I've been reading that maybe 20 years from now, we'll get to do what you're saying.
So it is important, though, to realize these things can be coming from both sides. So for example, if you look at the field called transfer learning, there what they're looking for is what I would call mathematical regularities. But in fact, again, we're using these kind of tools that are generally not discussed mathematically. But so the idea is, I've learned something in this context, how do I map it over to that context? There's been a lot of progress in that area, again, mostly for low-level problems, a lot of them network problems where you can find this graph models to that graph, so you can do some mappings, things like that. There's been a lot of work for many years in what's called analogy learning, things like that. So you know, often we teach children, you know, a good way to think about the atom, which turns out not to be a good way to think about the atom, is like the planets going around the sun, right? So we say, you know, you have these things and these orbits and things like that. So it's actually humans learn very well by analogy, right? Machines don't at the moment. So that's another area people have been looking at. So, you know, if you've been doing this a long time, what you see is a lot of these problems are looked at in a lot of different ways in sort of, you know, these fields that don't really talk to each other. And then what happens is when some of this breakthrough stuff starts to happen, some of those start to come together. So I, on an optimistic day, will say, you know, we've already seen neural learning and reinforcement learning starting to come together in some very powerful ways. We're starting to see some of this transfer learning in there. That. So I think we're at the beginning of something that has a long way to go. But again, my one thing to say is think of it more as an engineering or a mathematical discipline that also has this stuff we can learn from humans rather than thinking about it as the study of human thinking. And I think mm-hmm. you're in a much better place to understand where we are and where we need to get to.
Thank you. So we're pretty much at the end of our conversation. I think you'll get lots of opportunities to ask other questions to our panelists. So I thank you all, Christine, Jim, Doriana, and Munir. Thank you for participating.
Thank you. Thank you.